Hi everybody, I'm Tim from troutandfeather.com, and in this fly tying video I do a review of the Norvise. Stay tuned. Through my Trout and Feather website there's a contact page, and within that page there's a little form that people can fill out, and whenever they click submit I get an email directly in my inbox, and the questions are always about fly fishing or fly selection, about certain materials used in flies. I get a lot of questions about the mugs I use in my videos, but easily one of the most frequently asked questions relates to vise selection, and it's really easy to understand why, and it's because there are so many vises out there and it's really difficult to figure out which one's perfect for you. And the reason it's really difficult is that, as I love to say, if you ask about 20 different tires which vise is their favorite, you are possibly able to get like 17 different replies, because there are so many vises out there. There's certain tires who've been using the same vise for 25 years. There's other tires that like to get a new vise every few years, and it's a really personalized decision. So I really want to start this video by saying that up front. There's a lot of people who have used a certain vise that they have just absolutely loved for the last decade, and they're going to say adamantly, this is the vise to use. Well, my intent of this video is to review the Norvise, and it's a really unique vise, and it's one that's really kind of stood out and it's stood the test of time, at least over the last decade. It's a vise that, no matter what, if you talk to people about it, they're going to have an opinion, and it's typically a good one. I can tell you that prior to making this video, I set up the vise, I tied on it, and I tied a ton of flies on it, and then I kind of sat back, I wrote down all of my thoughts about it, then I emailed a bunch of people, and I asked them what their thoughts were about it, because I knew there's a lot of people out there that tie on this vise, and it was really interesting to see all of the thoughts, and it was really interesting to see what I agreed with and what I disagreed with, and I think you're going to pick a lot of that up in this video. Well, throughout this video, it's really my goal to show you a little bit more about this vise, because it's just a little bit different than a lot of the other vises out there, and by no means is that a bad thing. It really separates this vise from so many others. I'm going to tell you about really some of my positive experiences I've had with it. I'm going to talk about some of the negatives as well. At the end of the video, I'm going to reach out to everybody and really stress that if you have used this vise before, please by all means mention so in the comments section, because your experience is definitely critical to helping others make a decision with this vise. Now, before you go any further in this video, understand that there is actually a website that has a bunch more videos about this, and it's the website in which you can purchase this vise through. It's norvise.com. But I'm going to really kind of break it down, talk about the different flies that can be tied with it, kind of give you a quick peek of it, give you kind of my own experience with it, talk about some things that really separate it from others, and then most importantly, talk about the bobbin system that's used, because in my mind, man, the bobbin system that this vise's creator, Mr. Norm Norlander, came up with is just ingenious. I love it. And again, just like all things, there's positives and there's negatives, and I think the positives easily outweigh those negatives, but in the end, ultimately, it's you that's going to make that decision. So with that said, I'm going to change the camera angle a little bit, give you an overview of the vise, and then really just really nitpick and talk about some different things about it that I've noticed and show you some different things that you can do with it. So let's get things kind of changed around a little bit, and let me start showing you the Norvise. So here you see the Norvise system. Now let me talk a little bit through this device. This pedestal that you see, there's a base, and I'll kind of go over everything that really makes up this system and then get into more specifics. Well, for starters, when my vise came, it came with this board on it. I'm not sure if you're able to see this. It's a bamboo board, a few things set up on it. And what this bamboo board does is it really helps to set the distance from your vise to this bobbin pedestal. Now we're going to get more into the pedestal in a little bit, so let's concentrate next on the vise. So we have the vise, it's set up, and it looks a little bit unique. It looks a little different than that vise you may be used to seeing, and that's because it was designed this way. Now let me just grab a size 8 streamer hook. I'm going to place this into the vise. Now for starters, we have a few things going on here. This vise can spin. It locks in place. It locks every 90 degrees, so we can lock it. It has an adjustment so I can actually tighten it so it will not spin. I can loosen it, then it will just spin, you know, really significantly. You can see there's a little material clip on it. And then I want you to take a look at the reverse side. I have this screw that's in here that helps to kind of tighten the jaws a little bit, and then they finish getting tightened with this piece here. So whenever I place a hook in the vise, I'm just gonna tighten that pin, and I want my hook to go into this vise so the shaft is coming straight out from that piece of metal. Now if you do it correctly, whenever you spin it, it will look nearly perfect. There should be very little play. And what I've found from tying on this vise, I don't always put my hook in perfectly straight. Now, is that going to influence your tying? Yes, no, but in terms of this vise, it is important that you try to get it as straight as possible, because the designer of this vise really intended this vise to be manipulated by constantly spinning. So you need that as straight as possible. Now we'll get into a few other features that have kind of changed the system later, but that's the base system right now. Is it strong? Absolutely. Again, this is a size 8 streamer hook. I'll just bear down on it. I think you can see it bending pretty significantly. We'll put this through the typical hook test. The next one I'll show is a large one. This is a saltwater hook, stainless hook, size 1. I'm going to have to open it up a little bit. Lock it in place. And again, you can see it's bending. No worries there. We'll go down in size. This is a size 16 Daiichi dry fly hook. So lock it in place. It's not going to go anywhere. And then finally, we'll go to a size 20 scud hook. And just like the previous ones, it's not going anywhere. You're going to be bending the hook before you bend the actual vise. So that's really the way that the initial part of the system works. But now let's talk a little bit about kind of, I guess this is probably one of the more unique parts of this system, and it's going to be the bobbin. So let me get a hook back in here. I'll start with this streamer hook because it's a pretty good one. Nice size to see. It's a little larger for the video. Well, prior to getting this vise, I've heard a lot about their bobbin system, the Norvise system, and it's a really unique bobbin in that you can move it anywhere you want, and it stays at that setting. Now, I'm not going to get into the specifics because, quite frankly, I'm not an engineer, but it's a really interesting system in that whenever this bobbin was designed, the bobbin's intent was to be able to move, and it was to be able to move with this vise. So we have it on the vise, and it will just stay wherever you want it to stay. And I can tell you that whenever I first set up the bobbin, I really had to kind of take a step back, read the directions, and make sure that I did everything correctly. They have little arrows on here. It tells you how to load it correctly, and it makes sure you just kind of follow those directions, or else it may not work perfectly. But once you have it, we'll say at the correct setting, you're able to move this up, and it will just stay there, which is really unique. The other great thing about it is that as I loosen the vise, I can simply hold on to the bobbin and start spinning. And I can move the bobbin and the thread anywhere I want really quickly. So I can accumulate a lot of thread buildup in a very short amount of time. Now that's a really wonderful thing. Now, if you remember, I said near the beginning, we have this pedestal. And the reason we want this spaced out correctly is because that pedestal is used a lot for holding our bobbin. As we're manipulating materials, as we're getting things ready, we have to have that, we have to have a holding place for it. And you're gonna see this holding place come into action here in just a little bit, because again, this vise has a lot of versatility because it's a little bit unique. It doesn't operate necessarily the same way as every other vise. Can it still? Yes, without a doubt, but this rotary feature that it's built into it is really unique. Hence the reason why this bobbin was designed to be able to release thread at a very, very slight tension, just enough to kind of hold it in place. So that's just a general overview of how this vise works. Up to this point, whenever I first opened the package, got everything together and used it, everything really went relatively smooth. Was it a little difficult at first to kind of transition from the vices I had been previously using? Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, it's a new tool, and you have to learn all the little goodies that are associated with it. So next, let me kind of change things up. I'll get this thread off and let me show you a few more things about the bobbin, and then I'll actually tie some flies, or at least tie some materials onto this hook, and kind of show you a little bit more about the versatility of the Norvise. In this segment of the review video, I'd like to really focus on this bobbin, because the Norvise system in general is really unique, but specifically this bobbin separates it from so many others on the market right now. What I can tell you is that I know of a lot of tires who tie simply with the Norvise system bobbin with their regular fly tying vise. And I shouldn't say regular, as in this is not a regular vise, but this bobbin system alone is a really popular item, and there's a good reason for it. Now, as I mentioned before, it was created specifically for the Norvise because of the notion of this Norvise being a vise that has the flexibility to offer you some really incredible rotary features. Now, with that rotary feature, this bobbin was designed to allow the thread to just release immediately onto the hook, yet that bobbin can stay in place and you wouldn't have to manually take thread off. Now, there's a clutch built into this, and it allows this bobbin to go so far, and then after it hits a certain point, maybe 10, 12, 15 inches, somewhere around there, then it kind of stops and it resets. And I'm not going to get into that specifically. Well, a few things that I've kind of, I'll tell you a few positives and a few negatives of the system. For starters, the bobbin's a really high quality bobbin. It's got that ceramic tube, never had any thread issues. It works really well. I mean, you have to, again, look over the instructions, get everything set up, but once you have it set up correctly, it works really smooth. The bobbin, I believe, comes with four of these, thread holders. Now, they come bare and you have to load your thread yourself. And that's kind of the one criticism that if I have any of this system, it's that it takes a little bit of time to load these yourself. Now, does it take that much time? No, definitely not that much time. It comes with a little quick spooler. This has a little rubber gasket. It goes on here. I just simply put it in my drill, attach this, grabbed a spool of thread, locked it in place on this, hit my drill, thread instantly gets on, and then you have it locked and loaded. So I have a bunch of these. I have a few more of these. They already have thread on them. This is the only one that does not. So to me, the downside is that if I want to change colors, I have to take this, in this case, the black thread off, and then re-spool it, put whatever color, we'll say brown, light tan, on, and you have to wrap it around here a couple times to allow for the tension, and then put it through the cylinder. Now, is it that big of a deal? Yes and no. If you're kind of like me and I tend to tie maybe a dozen of one fly, then I switch to another fly and tie a dozen of that, and I'm constantly switching threads, yeah, it can be, because my normal setup has around 20 bobbins just set up ready to go, loaded with my 20 most popular colors and sizes. So let me stress that as well. So in this case, it can be a little bit more tedious. So if you do decide to invest in this type of a system, I would consider purchasing more of this actual, the stem, simply because then you can have some preloaded and they're ready to go. Without a doubt, that's my biggest criticism of this bobbin system, because the positives really just outweigh it. You can get a lot of thread loaded onto this thing. It works flawlessly. I've never had an issue with it, and it's just wonderful. I use it on all my vices, not just on the Norvise system, and it's really just very smooth. Now, the one thing that I'll kind of tell you, and I'll be honest in this video, the Norvise has, there's lots of YouTube videos. It comes with a DVD. I think I have two DVDs on the Norvise system, and like most, I got everything set up and I decided not to watch the video first. Instead, I wanted to just tie with it and see how it went. So I was tying with it, and I would run into some difficulties where I wanted to get stuff onto my thread here, but I wasn't quite sure how to get it. And then the other difficulty, whenever your thread's off, let me just unwrap this. Whenever your thread's off, if I would release it right now, if I would let go with my right hand, this thread would just come shooting through it. And I couldn't figure out exactly what I was to do with that until I watched the video. Then I realized there's a reason we have a pedestal. On my side of the pedestal, there's a little stop that you can actually wrap that bobbin around and it stays in place. It's really nice. I should have watched the video at first. But then by watching the video, that's where I also learned that right now, again, I can release it and it will just start to go back. But if I pull it so far, I actually can feel the stop. And now I have no tension on the thread right now until I start again. So I can just put it down, set it on my pedestal, and everything's great with this. So what I can tell you, kind of, I guess my overview with this bobbin, before I get back to the vise, is that I absolutely encourage you to check this out. If you do a lot of rotary feature as well, on a Norvise or on another vise system, this is a really awesome thing to have. So say you're cranking out a lot of streamers, maybe a woolly bugger, and you know you tie a bunch of those. Maybe you're a commercial tire. Maybe you know you just tie them for a local fly shop, and or maybe you know you just give them away to your friends or sell them occasionally, and you're gonna be tying, you know, 10, 15, 20 dozen woolly buggers. Having this type of a bobbin really will allow you to crank through it a lot faster, and I'll show you some of the features that this allows for in the next segment. As I mentioned, the downside, it's a little bit of a hassle to put new thread on it every time versus having all of my bobbins set up. Can you make the investment and get a bunch of these? Yeah, without a doubt. It's tough for me being in this, you know, 26 years now or 27 years and saying, great, I've already invested X amount of money. Should I reinvest in one more thing? That's really kind of that deciding point on this bobbin and on the Norvise system, you know, altogether. But in short, if you had to kind of say, do I recommend this bobbin or not? Unequivocally, yes. It's a really cool system. I would recommend you checking out his website. I think it's norvise.com, to at least look into the bobbin first, because it's really unique. This is really something that I would at least start with. And then if you decide to make the jump up to the Norvise, by all means, do it. So now that we've kind of talked and addressed a little bit about this bobbin, let's get back to the actual Norvise, and I'll show you a few more of the cool features with the system. At this point in the review video, we've talked a little bit about the vise, the pedestal, this stand for our bobbin. We've gone over features of the bobbin. Now let's talk about some of the goodies, some of the really interesting components of this system that really kind of sell it with so many people. Well, the system, in my opinion, is really intended to tie a lot of flies in the round using the rotary features. What I mean by in the round is that basically whatever material you're putting on the hook, it's going to be the same around all 360 degrees of the shank. Now, is that true of every material? No, absolutely not. But this one really excels in that direction. So let's just kind of start with a few of the basics that you're probably used to seeing. All right, so we have our thread tied in, just typical. I'm going to advance it to the back. Sorry about that. At this spot, I'm just going to grab a piece of chenille. This is chenille that you're going to be using for, I don't know, woolly bugger, some type of streamer, some larger nymphs. I'm just locking it in there, any spot for now. Let's advance this thread up. Now my thread is hanging. I don't have to worry about locking it, doing anything crazy like that. I can now simply just grab the chenille, wind it forward just a little bit, and it's quickly at the front. At this point, I can bring my vise back, let it hang as I switch hands. Looks like I did not lock this. And at this point, just quickly lock that chenille in place. So you can imagine how easy this would be if we're dealing with, you know, woolly buggers, those types of flies that really just have that material that's being brought up quickly. I'm gonna try to switch this out and get to another material, because I think that's a pretty basic one. Now the next material that I wanted to kind of play around with was dubbing, because I heard that this is a really neat vise and it has some pretty cool capabilities when it comes to dubbing. See if that's straight. Not bad. Which, by the way, I'm not sure if you're hearing any rattling. Where I'm setting this video today, the stand is up a little bit higher. This is not my tying table, so it's not perfectly flat. So if you've noticed this thing moving at all and that it's just a little wobbly, it's definitely because this is more for a video location, not for my actual tying. So I want to stress that normally you want to have this on a very flat surface. All right, next, let's get back to our bobbin. Same tying procedure as before. And then I tend to run this back, and I like to keep this bobbin tip as close as possible, because it really allows you to kind of get in there, and there nothing will happen to your thread. I really like that component of this vise. Well, the next material that I really wanted to play around with was dubbing, because I heard that it's really unique in the style that it goes on. So I'll tell you for now the second time, there's this DVD instructional video that came with it that I chose not to watch. So I tied some flies up and I just dubbed them the normal way I dubbed them. This is a darker, hairier dubbing. Then I watch this video and they apply this dubbing by literally spinning it and it just kind of goes on. And I watched it three times. In fact, I said to my wife, Heather, you got to watch this because this something's just not right here. And it just went on magically. And it all that's really going on is that the thread is spinning. You hold on to the thread to make sure it doesn't continue to spin, then bring it back and apply it anywhere you want it. And it truly works just like that. I tend to use this for larger flies on this system. I'm talking sizes 8 to about a size 14. If I'm dubbing anything smaller than that, I tend to still go back to that regular dubbing style. The one thing I noticed is that it really allows the dubbing to go on spiky whenever I am using the rotary feature. So to get this going with dubbing, simply pull that out so now you can spin. Start spinning, and as I spin, I got some other stuff in there. I'm just gonna let it touch, and once it starts to grab, I'm gonna just let it grab the rest of the way down. So check this out. All right, start to grab. I'm just gonna let it grab the rest of the way down. And I have a bunch of dubbing on there. Just gonna hold on to the thread, stop everything, because I don't want that thread to unspin too much. Now I'm just going to basically bring this dubbing anywhere I want it. Once I have it locked in that right place, now I can advance it forward. If I have to go back a little bit, I can create a little bit of a larger head. Boom, and I'm done. So now I'm at the spot where I can get my thread locked in place, pull all this remaining stuff back. If I really wanted to, add some hackle. More than likely, this is probably going to be behind a bead head, but you can kind of get the gist that it goes really quick. So there it is with just some, relatively loosely dubbed hair's ear dubbing. Now, if I want to show you one more thing, this is probably the most impressive to me in terms of dubbing. I have this material. It's made by Spirit River. It's called Light Bright, LiteBrite. It's got some really great shimmer abilities to it. It really reflects a lot of light. It's a pain in the butt to dub. You can see it's almost like a plastic material. I figured if I could get this to dub with this Norvise, then there's no doubt this Norvise at least has the capability to dub some really difficult materials. So let me show you this light bright dubbing with the Norvise. So same system before, just got it up there. Just gonna let it start to grab some of this stuff. Sorry, turn it around a little bit. You can see it just grabs it, spins it in place. I don't like how that kind of finished at the end, so I'm just gonna bring it back. Hold on to it, lock. Now, let's see if I can get this back to where I want it. I'm just going to kind of walk it back there just a little bit. This is the one problem I sometimes have is I don't want it to hit my hook point too much, or too much of a buildup. And there we go. Let me get all this stuff up out of the way. You can see it definitely dubs it on there. I put it on a little bit thicker near the thorax. And more than likely, this is going to be dubbing that I'm only using either in the thorax or the abdomen. So it's not going to be all just centered right there. But the gist is that I want you to see that, look at that, all that stuff just going all over. I really like this dubbing, by the way. You can tell with this Norvise system that it really does have that ability to kind of grab these dubbing materials and just get them immediately onto your thread and onto the hook. You have the ability to control how much you're putting on there. It's something that first week, the second week, it was tough for me to really figure out. It seemed to either get too much or too little. And then after I used it for, for a short period of time, I was able to really control how much I wanted. It works for dry flies, wet flies, really whatever types of materials you're going for. Now, for those of you who've watched my videos over a long period of time, know there's one one or two materials in particular that I really tend to use on a regular basis, and it's peacock curl. Now, I think there's something borderline magical about it. My mentors have always just told me about the benefits of it. You got to have it on flies that catch fish, period. And I wasn't sure how this system would kind of align with it. Sure enough, there's mention of it in one of the videos, and it really works kind of the same way. But what's neat about using peacock on it, let me just grab these. I'm just going to grab two pieces. Anytime I use peacock, I tend to trim the tips. I'm just going to lock it in place. Now, wherever you lock it in place, that's truly up to you. But what's neat about this one, in this case, I'm going to do pretty much the same thing that I did with dubbing. But I'm going to hold the peacock towards my... I lost a piece there. Sorry. I'm going to hold the peacock towards my... my cradle for the bobbin. Sorry, let me get all this stuff completed again. I'm worried too much about the video than I am about the material. All right, so as I'm holding it this way, we can now simply go through that same procedure as before. And now what we're doing is reinforcing this hurl. Stop where we want it. Bring it back. Say I want to wrap it around there a little bit. Don't want to get that cut. And now bring it forward. We can create a really fast and a really, I want to say significant hurl body. The really neat thing about this is that you can also use that with a wire. So if you're thinking about reinforcing it with wire as well, you can complete that build up that way with a wire. There's a secondary system that also gets sold along, that gets sold separately from the Norvise that I'll show it to you a little bit later. And it's to create wire dubbing brushes, or you can create any type of dubbing brushes in a sense, but a peacock dubbing brush is really a neat thing to do. But if you see how simple it was there to just put that on, it builds up the body really nice, and it just looks, you know, great. It really does look really good, and it's reinforced, which is an important thing. So whenever you're looking at it in terms of a few of the goodies, think about the types of stuff that you put on a hook on the round or in the round that goes the whole way around the hook. We're talking dubbings, hackles. What do you do? Do you believe this could do it a little bit more efficiently for your tying? So that's something that you may want to take into consideration if you're thinking about purchasing a new vise, specifically if you're going to consider purchasing the Norvise. If you are putting a lot of material around the hook, like these dubbings, chenilles, this peacock hurl, then this may be a vise that you're going to want to lean a little bit towards. All right, next, let's talk a little bit about another reconfiguration with the vise. Well, hopefully you noticed there has been a change made to the vise, and that's the addition of a second set of jaws. Let's talk a little bit about the Norvise and the transition it's kind of gone through. Whenever I was looking into the Norvise, I was reading a lot of the reviews that came out really early on, and it seemed like there were a lot of tiers who were not too crazy about it in terms of tying small flies. They looked at it and they kind of said that the original set of jaws, though it was really excellent for larger hooks, it was really difficult to tie smaller hooks. And you could tell there was just a certain percentage of people that were just not interested because it didn't have a set of jaws that kind of looked right for smaller hooks. And whenever you look at the original set, can you think that? Yeah, I think when I looked at it as well, I kind of looked at it and thought to myself, geez, that looks great if I'm tying those larger ones, those hooks for stripers, for steelhead, the larger trout flies, maybe size 12, size 14s. But when you think about size 18, size 20, size 24s, is it possible? That's the main question. Now, whenever I got that DVD, you could see the vise's creator, Mr. Norlander, he heard that group of fly tiers, and there was some early footage of him tying smaller flies on the original jaw, basically just to say, hey, it can be done. And it was fascinating to see that he did that, but then he definitely, you know, he listened to his customers and he realized as much as he might be able to say, hey, it can be done, there was still that group of people that just didn't buy it necessarily. Thus, he decided to create the new fine point jaws. This is definitely intended for smaller hooks. Can it tie larger sizes? Sure, but I really wouldn't go much larger than a size 12 with these jaws. Not for any engineering reasons, just because in my mind, their intent is definitely for smaller hooks. Now, pros and cons of this, for starters, the main pro is that you're gonna be able to tie smaller hooks. You're gonna be able to access around the bend. Now, can you, depending on where you place the hook in the original jaws, sure, but in this case, you're going to be placing this hook further out from the base. And that's one of the cons of this jaw system, is that whenever you have your original system, that hook is coming straight out, it's perfectly in line, and it's closer to the base. And if you just think about it, the further you get something from that center point, the more play there's going to be. And is there more play in this? Yeah, sure, there has to be, it's further out. I can tell you that a downside of whenever I tie in this and I try to use the Norvise system by spinning, it's tough because if you're gonna be using a curved hook, you've kind of defeated the purpose of an inline system. So whenever I'm tying scud hooks with these fine point jaws, these smaller sizes, and especially like a Limerick bend, this style bend, I tend to have everything locked on this side. I have this in place and I clamp it down so there's no play at all. And instead I can just focus on tying in more of that traditional manner. I have access around the bend. I can get everything I need on it. If I'm a little closer towards the head and I decide I do need to build up wraps, can I? Absolutely. Do I? I tend not to. Let me just lock this in place. I'll get a dry fly hook in here real quick. That was a size 20 scud. Here's a size 16 dry fly hook. Now whenever I tend to put these ones in, I tend to have them up a little bit more. So I'm just locking them really in that bottom third of the hook, kind of like those traditional vices. I think it might be pointed down just a hair. But that's the way I tend to put them in. So if you're thinking of it from that inline perspective, is it perfectly in line? No, can you get it in line? Yeah, without a doubt, you definitely can. The more you play around with it, but you have to decide how much access do you want to the back, and do you want to have that ability to kind of reach around and to access other materials while you're putting them in place. In my mind, would I have the Norvise system without this? No, I really like this upgrade. I think the fact that it's a fine point jaw, you can really kind of see around the bend of the hook. That's what I tend to prefer whenever I'm tying with, especially dry flies and midges. I really prefer this profile. It's an upgrade though, so you have to make that decision. As of 2016, I believe the Norvise system itself with the original jaws and this pedestal is around $295, let's just call it $300. And I believe the upgrade for this fine point jaw is another $100. So now we're talking about $400 to have both sets. Will that basically cover all of your tying needs? Yeah, absolutely. There's no doubt about it, and it's a quality tool as well. In terms of convenience of getting this on and off, very simple. Just gonna turn it upside down. It comes with some Allen keys. There's a set screw inside there. In this case, we're just gonna loosen it. Once we have it loosened, that set pops out. We can pop our original jaws right back in. Tighten them. And then you're ready to go again. So very convenient, really nice, very practical, great application. Again, pros and cons of the pro being you're able to now tie smaller flies. The con, it's a $100 upgrade and you're out a little bit from that center point in terms of the rotary and the inline system. In my mind, if you are going to go with this and you tend to tie smaller flies, by all means, get this right away. Now, can you buy it later? Yeah, absolutely. You might get this system and realize, you know, you are able to tie those size 16s on it without a problem, those size 18s, those 20s, and it works for you. Again, in that DVD, it shows that it's without a doubt possible. And once you become fluent with this vice, it definitely can be possible for you. And that's not the decision that you're going to have to make. But I did want to at least show you that upgrade because I know a lot of viewers on my YouTube channel know that I'm more of a trout guy. I tend to tie a lot of smaller flies, and this jaw system right here, the fine point jaws, this is what you'll see whenever I am using the Norvise, more than likely. Before giving my final recommendation, let's go through some pros and cons of the Norvise system to really help to kind of narrow everything down, and so I can also, you know, hopefully help you make a more informed decision. We'll start with the pros. We'll stay positive. This is called the Norvise fly tying system. The word I have to stress is that this is definitely a system. I've already showed you the base vise. We talked about the fine point jaws. We talked a lot about the bobbin. You have the opportunity to buy this bobbin board. We have this pedestal for the bobbin. Now let's talk about some things you haven't seen yet. There's a dubbing brush component. There's a tube fly component. I'll be showing both of those to you guys in later videos. There's a waste basket that I have that sits in the front. I don't really use it. That's a really nice thing, especially for those that really like to keep all their materials organized. You can purchase a magnifier for this. There's also a gallows attachment if you're thinking about tying parachutes or extended bodies. So there are so many different components to this that have definitely been thought out. So keep that in mind. If you decide to go this route, you're not buying just a vise. You're buying the opportunity to kind of modify the vise as you need it, because there's all these other components that are already there, they're already existing, and then you can add on to your base vise. Next thing I have to say is that in my mind, there is no doubt this is definitely the best vise out there to tie flies in the round. I mean, whenever you think about the notion of this being that zero, that center, spinning it, I mean, it looks perfect. It's easy to access. It's really great. All the various sizes of hooks. I mean, I showed you a size 1 the whole way down to a size 20. But again, thinking about that flies in the round, getting stuff 360 degrees around that hook, this thing is definitely built to do that. So if those are flies that you're tying a lot, by all means, really check this one out. It's really easy to use dubbing and body materials with this one, as I showed you a few of those different dubbings. Also, the reinforcement of materials is definitely a huge plus. I showed you peacock, but you can also do that with hackle. Think about some materials that you use on a regular basis, maybe buyout bodies, those that you know might tear easily. Instead of super gluing them or putting some type of a wire counter wrap, instead, you can simply reinforce them with your thread. So kind of keep all that stuff in mind. There's a lot of perks to the notion of reinforcing some materials with this. And finally, I think one of the biggest pros that I have for this is that it's really easy to contact the owner, and he seems really willing to improve this vise or all the components based on suggestions from his customers. There's a lot of tires that I reached out to, many that I knew that used the Norvise, and I just asked their opinion of it, and I was curious what their own thoughts were. And there was one gentleman, his name was Glenn, and he talked to he emailed me back and was saying how he's had many detailed conversations with Mr. Norlander, who created this, about ways to improve it, especially for smaller flies. And Mr. Norlander made those changes. So to me, that really that says a lot about an owner that's willing to say, hey, even though I think that maybe everything I have it's great, it's borderline perfect, it's working really well for everything, well, there's some customers out there who don't think that. And he was willing to make those changes. Case in point was the fine point jaws. So I think that's a really huge plus for a company like this. So those are all the pros. Let's talk about a few cons, and some you may have noticed right away. For starters, in my mind, this is not something I'd really want to travel with. I tend to bring just a quick vise that either has just a small pedestal, or I can get a C-clamp and put it onto a picnic table if I'm tying outside. So this is not the most portable vise in my mind. Now, I know there's a case that you can put all this stuff in, but whenever I travel, I can tell you that more than likely, I probably won't be bringing the Norvise with me. Do some travel with it? Yeah, absolutely. But to me, this is not something that I would prefer to. I think I like having this base. I like having it drilled into my fly tying table so I can lock it in. There's no play whatsoever, and I know it just stays there. So kind of keep that in mind. If you've already been tying on another vise, then that could be another con, because now you have to become familiar with a second system and kind of a second style of tying. Can you tie the traditional methods on this vise? Yeah, there's no question about it. Say you choose not even to use that rotary feature, you can always simply insert the hook just like you normally do and start tying. That's not the vise's intent. So for those of you who have tied on another vise, really say to yourself, yeah, it's not riding a bicycle or anything like that, but so you are going to have to learn a few new techniques. Please, the biggest thing I can stress, do not be like me, and or maybe you want to be, and just tie with it for 2 weeks and then go and watch the DVDs. It was funny because there were a couple things that I just couldn't figure out. And there were a few other things that I figured them out. Like, for instance, whenever I was placing wire on it, I was like, man, I can put the wire in the eye of the hook and just spin it and hold on to it. And I just got it locked on there. And I kind of thought, I'm the one who figured it out. Then, sure enough, 2 weeks later, I watched that DVD and he showed you how to put wire on using that method. And some of those things that I couldn't figure out how to do, they were illustrated in the DVD. So, by all means, check those DVDs out. Check out his YouTube videos because they really will show you more of those interesting things that you can do with this that you may not just readily figure out. By the way, I will put a link to both Norvise.com and to his YouTube channel in the description of this video, just so you can kind of check everything out that I'm talking about and kind of see somebody who's a little more fluent at using this than I am personally. Some other cons, if you want to look at it from that. For me, it was difficult whenever I thought about adding tailing material. Say I'm going to add a tail to this right now. Let's say I'm going to be tying a woolly bugger and I have to tie marabou. It was just a little tough to access it with this base jaw in there. Was it a lot easier with the fine point? Absolutely. But if I was thinking about a woolly bugger, maybe I'm tying a size 6, it was kind of tricky for me to do that. And it was almost to the point where I had to just stop and bring this up a little bit. Now it's no longer at that true center. It's close, so it's definitely close. But that was kind of something that I thought about that I really had to, it kind of had me stumped at first. So that was kind of a con to me. And then finally, depending on your tying level, and in my mind, this is definitely advice more for the intermediate tier. If you are a beginner and you use this vise from, you know, right off the bat, please mention so in the comments section below because I'd like for other people to see that. And I'd be interested to hear about, you know, from you regarding your feedback with it. But this to me seems like the perfect vise that you've been a beginner, you're now thinking about making that upgrade, and you're just about to hit that intermediate tier of tying. This might be that vise for you because it allows so much more. And it has that entire system. So those are a few pros, a few cons that I wanted to go over. If there's anything that I've missed, especially for those of you who have tied on this system before, just like I just mentioned a moment ago, please mention so in the comments section because I'd love to hear more about what you thought about it, those pros and those cons, and I'll probably make a shout out to you one more time to ask you for those comments. Now with that said, let me kind of change the camera angle and get to my final recommendation for this vise. With all that said, we've now reached the final part of this video where I give my recommendation. And if you haven't figured it out by now, I 100% recommend this vise to all levels of fly tiers. The Norvise is just a great vise, and I also want to point out that it's part of a Norvise system. Now what I mean by that is that there are other components that you can add on to this vise, and I'll be reviewing those in future videos. We're talking about a tube fly component and also something that's really slick that's used to create dubbing brushes. So if you're not already subscribed to me via my YouTube channel, please subscribe or check out the Trout and Feather website in the future and look for those other review videos because there's some really other cool tools that relate to the Norvise system. If you have any technical questions regarding this, you're more than welcome to reach out to me. But more importantly, I think I would really recommend that you reach out to Mr. Norlander on his website, which is norvise.com. And if you decide to purchase one of these, be sure to tell him that Tim says hi. Well, with all of that said, thank you so much for watching this review video of the Norvise. If you'd like to watch more videos like this, be sure to check them out on my website, which is troutandfeather.com. I also have a Facebook page and an Instagram account, all that fun stuff linked to that page. And they're all under the Trout and Feather heading. So, you know, by all means, please check all that stuff out in the future. If you have any questions or comments regarding this Norvise, you can email me at tcammisa@gmail.com. But more importantly, if you've used the Norvise before or if you're considering using it, please mention so in the comments section below on the YouTube page. I kind of look at that comment section as more of a resource, kind of a running dialogue for all the fly tiers out there. And in this case, I know we have so many people out there that have used this Norvise before that really want to tell people about their experience. So please, by all means, do so below in the comments section to really help those out who are unsure whether this is the right vise for them. Talk about the style flies that you tie and any critique that you do have of the vise because it's great to get all that information out there so everyone can make a really informed decision. But with all that said, again, thank you so much for checking out this video, and until next time, thanks guys.